I didn't touch the tours, I didn't take part into this building, and I didn't know yet that I can to do so many things with this kind of basic skills.
因为我来之前以为至少会有一个师傅一直陪着我们，像我们自己劈竹子、切虎口什么的都非常的困难。
But when we doing the thing by ourselves, thinking through making, it will make us learn a lot how to figure the connection. Yeah, so I think it's pretty cool.
I love it. Like, I love the condition of like the non-knowing future, because you never know what happened in the future, and just follow the time and follow your heart.
So yeah, that repetitiveness, when you think about anything, repetitiveness is how you get better at something. So is that going to be the way to build and the way to design and the way to do architecture? No. Is that going to be something that makes them a better architect directly? No. But indirectly? Yeah. I mean, you understand how that might affect your process moving forward in terms of what you draw in the future.
In some ways, my work begins with being very lucky in terms of working with three offices early on in my career, Stephen Hall, Todd Williams and Billy Chen, both in New York, and then Stanley Sadowitz in San Francisco. Really great offices, and was fortunate to have a tremendous amount of experience there and a lot of responsibility. At a certain point, after working in those offices and others in New York, I decided to go back to school, go back to grad school, and ended up at Cranbrook Academy of Art outside of Detroit, where my thesis, my terminal project, was a house, building a house in Detroit, which ended up being the first residential project construction in Detroit in over 80 years. The thinking behind that was that it was more, less about architecture and more architecture itself. This work in research led to teaching in Providence, Rhode Island at RISD, where I taught for a number of years. From there, I was running a design build program for high school students in the Bay Area in Berkeley. That led to my current position where I am now. I teach lead faculty for a grad program at MICA in social design, where we're using and thinking about design to address pressing social issues. And in my studios, I'm deeply interested in two preoccupations, engagement and making. We are deeply invested in working with people and also real materials. So in some ways, it's a recognition of reality. This doesn't always mean building a building. We're deeply interested in and invested in building a conversation or a set of relationships. And while perhaps not every architect should build, maybe every architect should build once. So this is the space, this is the reality, where our project meets the elements of architecture. From the sky to the ground, threshold, passage, stair, we're confronting the raw elements of reality.
So Thomas is more of the traditional authoritative figure in the class, which is important because we don't want to completely dissociate from what students or people are used to in terms of a learning experience. because then it becomes something totally different. We want to make sure that we're within that realm.
What do you all know about what we're doing? What are we building? What are we designing? A workshop.
How big?
How big? Good question.
So my role is not the same as Thomas's role. It wouldn't make sense to have just a duplicate if we were doing the same job.
Yeah, let's go.
I mean, I consider myself the 13th student because we are making these decisions as a group.
So no matter what we do, we have a relationship to where we are building.
I'm not the one that they have to come to decide how to move forward. They do that as a collective. And if I want to be able to influence that, I need to be part of the collective. They take ownership of it, and then the only way for me to be involved is to be involved at that level. It just doesn't work from the top down in this type of project, in this type of environment, which is exactly what we wanted to create. Having the stair element. What Thomas and I do as a team is kind of represent two different sides of the same goal, which is to lead and provide the students with the ability to figure out the direction in which they should be led. So my involvement in both the small build and the big build was very much a part of the class. Thomas's role was very much a part of critique, providing reflection. That would be very hard for me to do if I'm in it every day, all day. If I'm focused on doing a physical task, you need that kind of perspective of the entire project, making sure the students are able to step back at times.
Ago, we came here to teach local people some handcraft. Because that's another NGO, they are protecting the local like drinking water. So after 2 years, we are very familiar with the people here. They like us, and we also fell in love with this area. I'm Lei, I'm working with Yuan and Chris, and we together create Pingwu Design Studio and the Room Design Library. The Room Design Library is an NGO, it's a research about the Chinese tradition craft. And transfer the craft to materials. And publish the materials to the designer from different countries.
And then in one point we realized all the research we have so far, we could share it to the public and help other designers if they are searching for specific materials or crafts. So then we opened the library.
The Ruicheng Design Library has proved that this research that they've accumulated over the last couple of years has led to the creation of some amazing artifacts, some amazing objects, inviting designers from all over the world to come use this research, use the resource of the library in the process of designing new things, creating new life out of these traditional materials.
Thank you.
And so we're asking questions that hasn't been asked of this research yet. We're using this research in ways that hasn't been used yet. So in that way, it's very important that we remain in close partnership with the design library.
This might lead us to something more interesting in the future, because if we keep bringing students and each course could be a different material, different functions, it means we will have one amazing, interesting workshop that can be even some educational purposes later on. So this is actually the plan that Des and us have, that after maybe 5 to 10 years we have maybe a school that was completely built by students.
What we're doing now is testing this research. We're saying, okay, you can do this. This is obviously extremely relevant and important at the scale of the object. What does this research mean at the scale of space, at the scale of architecture? I think from the first week and the first week and a half maybe of their experimentation with the material, maybe bringing in their previous experiences with bamboo and like preconceptions maybe, because I don't think a lot of them had used bamboo before. We saw a lot of, I would say, idealistic ways of using the material. Lots of curved lines, very ephemeral and light, and things that you would associate with bamboo if you've never actually tried to build with it before. So coming out of that, both Thomas and I were very concerned, is probably a good word.
We are learning bamboo works today. It's very, very exciting for me because they're a professional teacher who's working 20 years with bamboo. Actually, I just made a chair. I made it higher. Fit me.
It's important for us to take a very deep dive into understanding these materials and then making sure that we give ourselves enough time to make something real. It works into people's schedules much easier if we shorten the course to half the amount of time or a third of the amount of time. We could get a lot more participation, but we could never accomplish the scale that we're looking to accomplish with these projects and the usability that we're looking for these projects to accomplish. We want these things to have a life and to be more than just this sculptural artifact that is left over after the course is finished. And that takes time.
I think.
Cool. Draw. In our project, there existed the idealists and the realists. In reality, you confront that in every project you go into. The idealists and the realists, or the client's needs and the designer and craftsman and builder's capabilities. All of these things are very much a real aspect of real projects.
Abstract.
Yeah, they say you could do A, but you shouldn't do A.
We encountered these difficulties, but I would say these difficulties are, they happen everywhere and they happen all the time, and it's a perfect place to work through those difficulties and learn from them in terms of their ideas or their attitude towards design or their way to address different parts of a process.
The screen, I want to use the broken one, the sleeve.
I mean, that's part of the process, part of the design process. I mean, what we're doing now is designing, we're co-designing, we're all designing together. I mean, it would be very easy for, on one hand, for me or Dali or Dez or one of the students just say, okay, this is how we're going to do it. But that's not how we're doing it. We really want to build consensus. And part of that is compromise.
It's like intuitively, I'm like, yes. You know, like, this is your main asset.
I want to use some weaving. You know, the bamboo wife.
Mm-hmm. This part, so it's close to the people on the second floor. They can see the tall, the whole building space.
And some place for storage, like, maybe a small place for storage, because it's a large workshop. Yeah, they're still gonna go somewhere to for public.
前面看，就是三层。你个是窗户，窗户在这，可以。我先把窗户画上。哦，你们窗户在这儿，我以为窗户。So those idealists and those realists, yeah, they clashed the entire class. You could see it expressed in many different ways. It's not just like an attitude that you are exuding as a human being to another human being. It's the way that you work with material. There are just so many ways that manifests. Really made our project something that you always had to be critiquing. I mean, if everyone was on the same page, and everyone was moving in the same direction, and everyone agreed, if everyone was an idealist, or everyone was a realist on the team, yeah, we could say that maybe from the outside, the dynamic, the team dynamic might have looked more efficient. But I would say you would end up with a project that was bland. You would end up with a project that was not proceeding with doubt.
Everyone is special and unique.
First day of construction, the students put one piece of bamboo from the floor to the ceiling. On the second day, we had 16 pieces of bamboo up from the floor to the ceiling. And today at about 11 a.m., we've finished almost every column foundation. So they're moving exponentially faster, which I think is pretty great.
好啦，好累，我想休息，我想睡一觉。 个楼层的面板，如果做不规则型，我觉得很奇怪。
这老师，谁家是 know the whole idea， 谁家 have the whole idea and concept about the design but for the whole structure and how they connect with each other, how they grew up and they don't know so many.
你这边顶到这边五根柱子，
那这边要留，那这边要留出来，就是这边不能顶到墙，这边不是一个看台可以看出去的吗？
我现在想的二楼是，那这边有个小
的。我觉得不是应该先确定二楼的是什么样子再打柱子这种东西。
They're almost done with that column structure, and we have the stair group working on our next step, which is reacting to that column grid.Once the stair design is done, we have a way to react to the rest of that design. We have a way to move forward for the rest of the design. So in a way, this is extremely different than what any of these students have worked, how any of these students have worked before. And so I think that's a lot of why there's doubt and a lot of why there's a little bit of uncomfortableness, in what we're actually doing.Trying to do is figure out how to move step by step as a team and react to the step that we just had previously.
But we are trying to learn and discover something we don't know before from this unexpected process.
At the same time, like, we agree on necessary things to move us forward, so we're constantly moving forward. And so it's definitely narrowing our options, but it's also propelling us to make decisions and to be reactive to what we've done already, to take that seriously, and to trust our instincts also.
One of the really important questions that Thomas and I are asking about designing and building, but also practicing in the real world, is how do you proceed with doubt?How do you keep moving forward without knowing what everything is going to be in the end?
I think the ability or the notion that it's okay to fail is very important for this type of course to exist.Today was so shitty. Everybody's attitude, at the speed at which we're working. I mean, I knew that you guys worked late yesterday.
大概下半天之内啊、哦。
对啊。
几点钟啊？
昨天大概9:00-10:00。
明天？
9点。
9点半。
好无力啊！对啊，今天好累哦，心好累。
问他。
算是你真的很感兴趣的事情，你一直去做，而且保持一个每时每刻都要保持一个，就强迫你保持一个很积极的、饱满的心理状态，其实。
I mean, in the same respect that we need to be okay with failure, it's inevitable that there's going to be those moments when it's very possible that we will fail. I mean.We have a lot of students that have no experience in architecture. So even going into this project, it's very easy to say, well, it's possible we're not going to finish this.
我们是进行到一半了吗？
没有吧，我觉得百分之三。
45.
We have another plan maybe last week, and it was too hard, so we give up.
我只是在想，进行到这个阶段了，还有没有必要？
自己的缺点就是遇到一点困难就很容易想要放弃。
That doesn't hurt me. That one hurts this project, and two, it hurts us as a team.
谁想工作？昨天已经快哭了。
不用，你们可以去好好拍摄他们辛苦建功的过程。
那你呢？你也很重要。
没有，不重要。感觉没有达到预想的那个水平吧。可是。现在我连完成的样子都想象不到是什么样子。哎呦，我天哪！不行不行不行不行，我要走了，我真要走。有点。好了，不要拍，不要拍，不要拍，我真的走了，真的走了。
This project could either be really awesome, or wow, that was a good try.I would love to see this project be awesome. We gotta work hard. So, I think there's a difference between tired and having a low spirit. I think these students have worked harder than they have at any point in their lives so far. What we're asking of them is essentially something that they've never experienced before. And if anything, the students were exhausted. But that's also a huge part of this. I mean, exhaustion is what's needed to get to that point of understanding.
I say that to remind you that this is awesome work, and also that you've set a high bar for yourselves, for all of us, and that there's much more work to do.But we can do this.
So if you don't know what to do, ask her.
目的然后其实是完成那部分的固定，然后一木跟豆子是去给那个打洞，然后 Margie 和小白是去切纸。
Well, I think what's really interesting, we could talk about a pair of students, and we could look at their paths. And we had Eros, and we had Eve. Both very, very strong students in terms of capabilities, their education, and what they thought about design. And so these two came at this project, I would say, with a very strong sensibility in all of those.
Yes, true.
And in the beginning, they were working together. They accomplished this very beautiful chair, and that was the first kind of product between the two of them. And then as they advanced, they both worked on these planimetric drawings and models that were very, very whimsical. They both had curves. They were both using the bamboo in a way that they were essentially drawing in three dimensions. We had these lines that were very beautiful, but they were also kind of like floating in the middle of nowhere. And so we saw kind of this collective manifestation between those two of wanting to do something that was very hard to do out of bamboo. And then when you introduce the labor aspect of this, we get dirty. We're at the studio every day. We are cutting bamboo, we're bending bamboo, we're drilling, we're putting it up, we're tying it together. That's when you start to see these two students kind of diverge. And you have Eros beginning to adopt an attitude of wanting to build more orthogonally. Essentially, we start to figure out, okay, I now know that I've spent 7 hours today bending one piece of bamboo. I'm not going to do this for the 50 pieces of bamboo that we want to bend to do my design. So there, that was actually a physical moment in the course where Eros decided that. And I think that was a very big change in his design sensibility moving forward. You had this transformation happen in Eros. Now, if we go back, that moment that they start to diverge, Eve continues with this desire to have this curved or this whimsical expression of bamboo manifested in the project. I observed a lot of struggle in her relationship with the labor aspect of this. In a way, she was probably one of the most meticulous in terms of physically bending the bamboo, physically splitting the bamboo, very specifically into a joint. But she would always return to drawing. There would be a daily return to trying to think through the future plan, the image of the entire structure. Very, very big picture, a lot of planimetric drawing all the way through the end. As they diverged, you had Eros maybe taking on a role of building an enormous amount of the vital structure that holds things up. And you had Eve kind of stepping back and thinking a lot more big picture. And it's very easy to say that Eve became maybe a little dissociated with the process. But what's absolutely amazing, and I think maybe quintessential moment that we're looking for in this type of project, is when all of the drawings and all of the work that she was putting in for thinking kind of big picture becomes almost organically expressed through the need for a railing, a banister to the stair. That then led to this kind of gestural peeling a single bamboo piece over the main entrance, making a gate. It's impossible to say who is responsible for that, any one individual. Thinking back to Eve and her idea of the need for this whimsical gesture to emerge from the project that eventually manifested itself, and that's really beautiful. And I think the fact that these two took such different paths, starting from such a very similar point, is both an amazing way to summarize this project and the fact that every student has a different experience in this, but also extremely necessary for this project to look the way that it does and actually have been completed. I mean, we needed to have both of those in order for this to be a success. And that, I think, is a really amazing example, just by arbitrarily choosing two students. I mean, we could tell a similar story in each of them. All of these things are transformations in understanding what the hand is capable of, what the material is capable of, and what we as a collective body of individuals are capable of finishing in 6 weeks, so that it's still our project. We can build anything we want. What the big build is trying to get at is ownership of this by the students that are making it.